Hello, and welcome to Pragmatic Live, Pragmatic Marketing's webinar and podcast series, where we tackle the biggest challenges facing today's product teams. My name is Rebecca Caligaris. I am the Vice President of Marketing and Sales at Pragmatic Marketing, and more importantly to you, the host for today's event. Before we get started, a couple of housekeeping items. First, a recording of this webinar and a copy of the slides will be available afterwards. You'll be able to access them by the end of the day at pragmaticmarketing.com/live. Second, questions. We love questions. If you look to the left of your screen, you'll see a chat box. Feel free to enter any and all questions you have in that box, and we'll work hard to get through as many of those as we can. Third, there will be several videos used throughout the presentation. Using your computer speakers will give you optimal results for hearing those. Now, many of you are already familiar with Pragmatic Marketing, but for those of you not aware of us until today, welcome to the family. Pragmatic Marketing specializes in training companies and product teams on how to be truly market-driven. We provide techniques for listening to the market and gathering market facts, and then using those facts to shape strategies and drive execution. And we've been doing this and doing it quite successfully for over 20 years. Now, we've all sat through bad demos where you spend the entire time counting the minutes and praying for it to end. We have a good idea of what makes them bad, right? Ill-informed salespeople, generic presentations. But what makes a good demo? What makes it resonate with the listener and lead to sales? That's the topic we're going to explore today. And leading this discussion is Geoffrey James, who has spent decades observing and writing about how savvy sales and marketing people manage and motivate others. Geoffrey is a contributing editor and daily columnist for inept.com, and his most recent book is Business Without the Bullbeep, 49 Secrets and Shortcuts You Need to Know. All of which means we are definitely in good hands for the next hour. So without further ado, here is Geoffrey to get us started.
Thank you, everybody, for attending. And I have to admit, I have seldom looked more forward to a webinar, to a workshop, because demos are a particular hot spot for me, because I once worked in engineering, and I used to give demos, and then I worked in marketing, and I used to give demos. And since then, I've been a reporter, and I get all kinds of demos. So I get this whole world of demo experience from both sides of the table, and had a chance, probably seen at least 500 demos, and seeing what works and what doesn't work. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. So let's start with just kind of the overview of the rules. This will help you put everything we're going to see into context. There are six rules. I'm not going to read them to you because that drives me crazy. These are the six rules. This is not complicated. It's very easy to give good demos if you follow these rules. We're going to be going over each of those separately and showing you examples from videos of demos. Now, the reason why I'm using videos is because, first, it allows me to deconstruct what's happening in each demonstration, and also because demonstrations are increasingly given online, recorded as demos, and I've even seen some that we'll be seeing of small example of demos that are done as part of computer animation. So it's becoming a more online kind of action. People are doing that more than carrying physical items into people's offices as they used to. So this is going to be about using a lot of video. And so that's why if you're on a phone, you might want to try to get on a computer. I'll give a little bit of rundown of what's happening in each video for those of you who don't have that on the screen. Now, the most important thing about every demo is that it is a sales tool. It is not a tutorial. It is not a way for the engineering team to show all the cute, neat stuff that they put into a program. The only reason you give a demo in a sales situation, or a demo anyway, is to move the sale forward. It's a sales tool. And you have to keep that in mind every second you're planning and executing a demo, that if it's not helping you sell the product or service, then it is not helping your company. It's not accomplishing anything at that point. So you have to put sales tools, demos into the context of sales tools. There's all these places where people put marketing messages and sales messages, but the demos, and I show this in big type, because the demo is where it looks real. That's what makes it the most important sales tool. That's where it's real. I got an email the other day from someone who says, yeah, the demo, at that point, you're away from the BS. You got to really actually show the product. And but, and this is a big but, there's not just that getting rid of the BS. Yes, demos show the product really exists, and that's a positive thing. But that doesn't necessarily help the sales cycle move forward more quickly. It can kind of keep someone from not buying because they don't believe it exists. But for a demo to really have power, to really move people forward, to really get people to buy, it has to help them imagine what the world is going to be like after they buy the product. It's a form of storytelling that uses the imagination so that the customer can project themselves into what's happening and see, wow, I got to have that. We got to buy this. So with that in mind, you've probably seen plenty of demos, plenty of some on on web, some maybe on television, some maybe in person. So I'm going to start with a quiz, and I just want you to write the answer your answers to the in the chat area. And I'll give you about 15 seconds or so, and that's what CEO gave the world's best product demo? And I was going to play the Jeopardy music here, but I decided that was a little too corny, so I left that part out. So let's see what comes up with who gives a really, really good, really good product demo. And I'm watching the stream right up the side, and it's about 95% Steve Jobs, about occasionally Warren Buffett, occasionally someone had Henry Ford, mostly Steve Jobs. And, you know, we're actually going to be looking a little bit at Steve Jobs in a bit, but I'm now going to show you the video of the best, the absolute best CEO demonstration of all time. And here it goes.
Is it better to be feared or respected? And I say, is it too much to ask for both? With that in mind, I humbly present the crown jewel of Stark Industries' Freedom Line. It's the first missile system to incorporate our proprietary repulsor technology. They say the best weapon is one you never have to fire. I respectfully disagree. I prefer the weapon you only have to fire once. That's how Dad did it. That's how America does it. And it's worked out pretty well so far. Find an excuse to let one of these off the chain, and I personally guarantee you the bad guys won't even want to come out of their caves. For your consideration, the Jericho.
All right. Now, that is what I consider world's best CEO demo. And I'm going to be talking about why that demo is so good and what kind of walkthrough you're going to see in a little bit why that's so effective by looking at some other demos. Just some quick housekeeping. Some people are having trouble. They obviously can't see the video through the dial. And one of the problems with video is that it is a little more challenging. I suggest that you communicate with the moderator through the chat line if you're having problems with that. And I'll try to give a rundown of what we just saw or what we're seeing. I just let that one run on its own. For those of you who didn't see it, it was the demonstration scene from Iron Man where the fictional CEO, Tony Stark, demonstrates a missile system by having himself essentially blown by the shockwave. And as even though it's fictional, that was done by someone who understands product demos because it has all the characteristics of a great product demo. From the setup, where he says, and the way he communicates it as being of interest, something that was important to the people who are going to be demonstrated to. It doesn't talk a lot about the technology. It talks about what it does, and then it has a very tactile and dramatic demonstration that will be immediately meaningful to the people involved. Now, we're going to be going through all those elements and showing some different videos for that. And so let's move forward. Undoubtedly, the most ignored and most important rule for giving product demonstrations is don't explain things. You need to demonstrate. It seems obvious when you hear the term product demonstration because, oh, demonstration, product demonstration. Well, yeah, of course you're going to demonstrate. But surprisingly, many, many people, when they demonstrate a product, feel it contingent upon them to explain things about the demo or explain things about the development. So I did that myself. I remember my first product demo. I had invented this menu system that drove a publishing program. And first time I demoed it, I went through every menu pick on about like maybe 50 different functions. And I was surprised that everyone did not find that as fascinating as I found it, having programmed it. Now, a lot of engineers and a lot of engineering-driven organizations think that way. They think they need to be explaining things, saying, oh, this is how I designed it. This is what I did. This is what the product does. You don't explain it. You demonstrate it so that it shows what the product means to them. Now, I'm going to give you two videos that give you a contrasting example. The first one has a lot of explaining, and I'm going to break it down as it happens. So let's start with that.
Hi, I'm Lee Burnett with Dell, here with Brent Grossenheider with Dell. Brent, how are you?
I'm doing good today. How are you?
Well, doing really good. There's a lot of exciting things going on right now with Dell, Windows 8, our tablets, Ultrabooks, and convertible products. We talked in a video last week kind of overviewing the different products. And what we wanted to do today is kind of walk you through a demo of how Windows 8 works and some of the things that are really unique to that product.
Absolutely, absolutely. Today we've got the Latitude 10, which is a brand new product. I'm excited. This is the first one that I've actually seen as well.
Yeah, you may not see it when you leave this room, I can tell you that much.
Okay, now they've spent about an entire minute just talking about themselves, discussing their own reaction to things. And that's partly the format, but it's also irrelevant to the demonstration.
Really big step up in performance over the Latitude ST that we had, but we'll talk about a little bit about the device, but also Windows 8 as a platform, as I'd mentioned last week, I really like it myself.
Yeah.
There's a couple of little things that you need to learn.
Okay. Now he's not only explaining about the product, he's complaining about it. He's saying, yeah, I like it, with the implication that you probably won't. Now, this was a known kind of problem with the first version, with the version 8 of Windows that's since been corrected. But again, this is not relevant to anyone, how he feels about it or his opinions or his complaints. So let's go forward.
Done those. It's really dynamic in the way it works. You see the screen we've got up here? All these things are updating all the time. For example, here's the mail screen, and it's got the last email that I just sent to myself.
Well, I'll tell you what, how about we run through a demo and show us a little bit more about how this works?
Sounds good.
Okay, so when you turn on the device, you see a home screen here. How do you even get started? Because I know it's different than the old way we're used to thinking.
Now they're starting to get into the demo, but if you notice, they start complaining again.
Of Windows.
Yeah, and that's one of the things I think confuses people to begin with Windows 8 is how do you start? I mean, you get to the home screen and they go like this, and what do you do? Well, it's actually pretty simple. You just...
Okay. So now they're into the demo, and it's not as bad from then on. But if you see what they were doing, they were talking about the demo. They weren't giving the demo. They were explaining about what they would do and not really showing it. You want to say, oh, look, it's dynamic, and he's kind of pointing at a screen. That's explaining. That's not demonstrating. So now, everyone said Steve Jobs. Let's see how Steve Jobs demonstrated the product that started that product category. And briefly.
Using this thing is remarkable. It's so much more intimate than a laptop, and it's so much more capable than a smartphone with this gorgeous large display. So this is the lock screen. I unlock it. The icons fly in. Let's go right to the web. So here we are at apple.com.
Now you see what he's done just in that short amount of time. He did do a little setup. And he did say what it was and characterize it at how it positioned to previous products. But now immediately, he's doing things that someone would want to do. Boom, right into it. Right into it quickly. That's good demo practice. He's already jumping into the demo and jumping into how it demonstrates. I'm noticing I've been looking at some comments on the edge. We're going to be answering and questions. We're going to answer questions later, and some of those questions are really good. So I'm looking forward to answering on. So keep them coming, and we'll be flagging them and answering them at the end. So you see the big difference between, and these are two very similar products being demonstrated in very different ways. One is explaining, one is demonstrating. Key difference, demonstrate, don't explain. The other important point, or the next important point, is you have to keep it simple. And of course, that's been said over and over, you know, the KISS principle and things like that. But in demonstrations, there's kind of a little bit more to keeping it simple than let's say, even in a presentation. One of the things that you have to do to keep demonstrations simple, and this is true of sales messages in general and marketing messages in general, is that you want to avoid abstractions, which are not things that people do, but sort of a very remote way of talking about what they do. That usually comes out in demos, that this feature enables users to do this, and it's all, or talking about generalizations about the product category. Another way to keep things simple is you want to avoid features and functions. That's for a tutorial maybe. That's not for a demonstration. The more stuff you cram into a demonstration, the less effective it becomes. There's this thing that they say in sales about sales presentations, which is called spray and pray, which is where you just put up as much as you can, information as you can, and see if what sticks. That is really deadly in a demo because you're not focusing on a person, Jess, or slides. You're focusing on things that are happening in the screen or things that are happening in the physical world. That's more complicated to follow. So the more you get into complicated lists of things that something does, the effectiveness of your demo starts dropping and people's attention span starts dropping. And probably the most important part, though, is you want to look at a single problem. Remember, the idea is to get the customer really drawn in. And so the way to do that is to highlight a simple problem and then provide a simple solution. So now let's look at a couple of videos that do this right, or do this wrong, and then do it right.
So the first thing I'm going to show you on the payroll software, simply highlight the company that you wish to work on and click on the payroll icon at the top of the screen and then select payroll. You then select the year that you wish to work on and click OK. Down the left-hand side of the screen is where you add any employees. Down the right-hand side of the screen is where you enter any payments.
I see what she has done is she's structuring the demonstration kind of how the program's laid out. And she's showing a lot of screens where it's laid out. And there's no sense of context of why you would be doing any of these things. And as a result, it's kind of boring. Also, frankly, she's speaking in a monotone, which doesn't help. And I find that very ironic because the product she's talking about is actually really important to anyone, any HR group, and it'd be possible to get excited about it and be interested in it, but instead she's talking about the program, not about what it does for people, and so even she's bored by herself. You can hear it in her voice. Now let's look at another product demo where you see not only the right level of enthusiasm, but you see a setup that goes towards getting the person who potential customer to visualize what using the product might be like.
Hi, my name is John Martin. I'm with Reillusion, and today we're here at New York Comic Con showing you how you can animate any digital image, show you how we can do it. Basically, you can import your character just by bringing in a single JPEG image. So you can start.
Okay, now, I'm going to stop this for a second. You notice there's a fair amount of complexity there, but he has just said, oh, we're going to do this. We're going to animate a character. You call it a drawing. So he's already talking about what you do, not about what it does, but what you do. Watch again.
Simple piece of art or a photograph. And once you have that in, what you need to do is just fit four simple points to the face so that Crazy Talk understands where the eyes and the mouth are for your character.
Now, I could go on with the demonstration, but I want to let you understand that animating faces is in its own way just as complicated as doing payroll and setting up payroll systems, but he's showing it in such a way that the customer can immediately see where that's how it's going to fit and how they're going to use it. So big difference between the demos. Also notice his energy level. Partly that's because he's at a conference and he's got to speak loud, but you can tell he's excited about the products. He's excited about what it does. Okay, so now let's move to the next rule. And that's and you can kind of see that in the demos that we've looked at so far. You need to make it vivid. Now, vivid means, really is another way of meaning, you've got to touch people's emotions, or you have to make them take up and take awareness so that they really so that they really feel what's important about the product or what's important. And the easiest ways to do that are to put yourself in the customer's shoes before you give the demonstration. What if you were that customer, what would you be interested in seeing? What would be the story you'd want to hear? Obviously, you show some enthusiasm, but also you want to talk about real people doing real things. You don't want to keep it in, oh, the user does, yeah, blah, blah, blah. No, you do this. The product enables a company to do, no, you do this this way. Make it very direct. Demonstrations should always be direct, real people. And if you can do it, if the product's stable enough and if you're convinced it's simple enough, let the customer do the demo. It's of course only works if it's a live demo, but that is way, way more effective than any other kind of demonstration. So let's look at a couple of at a couple of examples here. And I'm going to try to up the sound a little bit on this one.
The HSE Analytics platform rebranded the Inform Performance Metrics tool that allows employers to rank their performance versus peers and examine performance over time. Employers are also able to ask questions and receive instant answers through on-the-fly examinations of health and safety issues and trends, only by considering the experience of your entire industry and all your peers. Is this possible?
I don't know whether you heard that at the beginning, but he actually started this part of the demo by talking about how his company had rebranded this product. I cannot think of a single thing that would be less interesting to a customer than how your branding strategy is. So he's talking about that. But if you notice, everything when he's talking about it, is in the context of, oh, your company does this, and it's very abstract. And again, this is so ironic because let me tell you what this product, which sounds like a bunch of gobbledygook when the guy's talking about it, what it does is it allows you to see how your company's doing in terms of people injuring themselves at work. That's real drama in that. It's really important because it means, you know, whether you're going to get regulated, it means whether you're going to get sued, it means whether you're going to be able to, you know, get the products out on time that you're making. It's exciting stuff, and yet he's presenting it with this, like, totally abstract way of thinking. And it has no basis in the person's reality. So here's another example. Now, this is just...
When a call comes in, you have a lot of options. You can mute it by covering Apple Watch with your hand, or scroll up with the digital crown to send a message, or transfer the call to your iPhone. You can tap the red button to decline, or tap the green button to answer, using the built-in speaker and microphone. Hey, I'm kind of busy. Can I call you right back?
Sure, no problem.
Okay, talk to you in a second.
Okay, now that was maybe not 100% fair because we're comparing a very complicated software package to what's obviously a consumer device. However, it is possible to demonstrate the iWatch in a way that's just as insanely complicated, like just going through all the menus and going through everything. But what's significant about this, what I want you to watch, is that they zeroed in on one particular feature of the watch, and then they brought it in so it seemed like something that you would be able to do yourself. I also might note that you may not have noticed, but the arm is computer animation. It's just a picture. It's not actually an arm being held there. And what that allows them to do is to control more of the environment of the demonstration. I'm seeing this more and more in demos where they'll take whatever can be animated to animate it and just put the stuff that can't be animated on top of it. It makes for a much more predictable demo, and I think it makes for a less distracting one because you don't see the hand moving, and it just kind of lowers the level of distraction. So, rule four is rehearse. And, you know, this should be obvious, but a lot can go wrong in a demonstration. A lot can go wrong in a demonstration. I share a personal experience in this particular case. So I had become involved in a system that was going to be used by the Iowa State Legislature to do bill drafting. And we were competing with another company, and I was at that point in engineering working with the salespeople on a prototype. And I built a prototype and was supposed to demo it live in front of all these state senators and state representatives in this huge auditorium. And I had never given a demo like this. I was so nervous about it that I actually went in the bathroom beforehand and threw up. That's how nervous I was about it. And I got up there, and all these people watching, and I blew it. I did something wrong, and it didn't work in front of all those people, and we didn't get the deal. And even though we spent many thousands of dollars pursuing this particular opportunity, and the problem there was that I hadn't really rehearsed. In a situation like that where you're going to be in front of a lot of people, you need to rehearse over and over again so that no matter what happens, you kind of can just go on automatic, that you're just going to be okay, that it's not tied into your particular emotions, but it's just something that you can do in your sleep, essentially. Now, I use for big demos and speeches and big presentations the same thing, what I call the 20-20 principle, is that you never want to give a presentation or a demo that's more than 20 minutes long. Probably shorter in a demo, but definitely no more than 20 minutes on any kind of presentation. By the way, this is why TED Talks are less than 20 minutes. It's because people's attention span does not last for longer than 20 minutes. I think you're lucky if you can keep people interested for 20 minutes. Most people have an attention span nowadays of about 30 seconds. And you practice at least 20 times before showtime. You want to make sure that you can give the demo no matter what. And it probably one of the best benefits of doing that, of rehearsing and rehearsing that many times, not just that you can give it in your sleep, but you come to the demonstration with this extraordinary feeling of self-confidence, which projects itself into your presentation and demonstration. And coming in with the self-confidence helps people feel better about if they were using the product, because they sense your emotional energy and the way you feel about the product, and they assume they're going to feel the same way about the product when they are actually using it. So it's an important psychological tool for yourself, and not just as a way to make sure that it runs well with your audience. Rule number four is have a backup plan. This is another reason. This will also make you feel more confident if you have one of these, but it can be really, really ugly if you don't. I told you about my own personal example. Here's probably the most famous example of a demo going wrong, and I just totally have to feel for the guy that's doing it. And
Surface is, of course, great for entertainment. It has access to all of the Windows apps for music, for video, for Xbox, and gaming. We can see here I'm running Internet Explorer. I can browse smoothly, see great pages using ClearType, and have a great experience just with all the with browsing. Its 10.6-inch optically bonded widescreen display is custom designed for Surface. And of course, people play games. I can go and play any of the interesting games that are in the Windows Store, and I can use Surface for using all the sensors that are within Windows as well. Surface works for all of those games.
Movies and entertainment look great.
Now I stopped it because it's actually kind of almost painful to watch it. He's stuck. He's built his demo completely around the fact that the device is going to work live. He doesn't have any spares, right handy, and he's just being forced to wing it. And he's continuing the same pattern for the demonstration, even though the device is no longer working. So, and here's where it goes.
It as well. Oops. Hang on. What? Excuse me, just a second.
So you see, he was not really ready for that to go wrong. Now, I can tell you probably what went wrong. What usually goes wrong in situations like that is that there's too many people using your wireless in the building, and that's a very common problem with demonstrations. So you, actually, he should have been aware of that, that that could have happened. He should have had something ready. So how to be prepared? Whenever possible, have multiple demo units. If one goes bad, the other one might not. You want to just have, if you can afford it, have extras, have extra presents, so you can just sort of switch over to the other one, say, and just kind of just pass over. Well, now we'll move on to this device. You definitely want to do multiple live tests before you do anything. And I apologize for some of the people that are having problems with the sound here. We did do multiple. We did do a live test, and we did make sure that this should work. And it is a little bit different using a lot of videos. And so for those of you who are having problems, I apologize, although I understand most of the people seem to be able to see these. You also want to have a canned video demo ready. If it's a big demo that you're giving to a large group of people, you should just have that queued up. Have that queued up, or even multiple videos queued up, starting from different places in the demonstration that might be problematic. And you can just switch over to the video. So now I'm going to show you a video how this is done, and just switch it over if the device isn't working. And this has been done. I've seen it done where if you watch carefully, I couldn't find an example on the internet, but if you watch carefully, you can see, oh yeah, the guy got hung on the demo, but he managed to seamlessly turn it into a video. This is just a standard practice. Again, some of the advantages of this is that your demonstration is less likely to go bad, but just as important, and maybe even more important, is that it gives you the confidence as you get up and give the demo that it's going to be as effective and that you're pretty much ready for anything. The next important rule is you have to be ready for technical questions. And this is because there's always some guy in the audience, some person in the audience who wants to drill down, wants to know how this little thing works. And this is because they want to know that you understand the product. So if you do not actually understand that depth, you must bring someone along with you who knows that depth or who can answer it. Or you have to say, I don't know, I'll get back to you on that. That's not as good as the other one. It's best to understand some of the technical background, but remember, you don't want to demonstrate the fact that you have that knowledge. You want to have it ready if the audience member asks how something is accomplished. You might bring someone along with you, as I say, an engineer along with you, or you might have someone on call who could answer questions, like someone on, you know, teleconferenced in or watching a streaming version of it so that they can be there to answer those questions. It's certainly a lot easier now than it was in the past where you actually had to drag the engineer along with you. But it's important to have that, especially if you're making this kind of, the kind of demo that's emotional to people, because that in a way, because you're showing how it would feel to use it. That's not the way an engineer necessarily is going to want to see a product demo. That's the way that the decision makers, the people with the money, are going to want to see the demo. And the people, the operational managers who are going to use it, that's the demo they want to see. But the engineers, if there's engineers in the room, they can't help but they want to know why. They want to know what. Why did you make that decision? They want to know a little bit of detail. So being ready to answer that just makes things easier for you, and it puts you in a situation where you can more realistically answer answer questions that otherwise might block the sale. Because remember, the point of the demo is to move the sale forward. And you don't want to have anything happen that's going to slow down the sale or that's going to cause a blockage. You want it to be able to move quickly under the next step or to whatever the next steps are as it plays a role in the sales process. And finally, let's get to rule number six, which is you have to close on the next step. And that's really, really the point of when I say when it has to be part of a sales presentation, that it has to be part of a sales process. You want to know where the demo is going to go or what you're going to be doing next with the demo. And so we're going to look at, I'm going to show you, go back again to the first demo I showed you, and we're just going to look at the close after the dramatic demonstration.
The Jericho. I'll be throwing one of these in with every purchase of $500 million or more. It's a piece.
Now, what he did was, that's what's called in for those of you who know a lot about sales theory, that's called an add-on at the end. That's a fancy version of, but wait, there's more. But you see, what he has done at that point is he's kind of assumptively closed, and he believes that the demonstration has been so powerful that they're going to buy it. So he says, oh, we're throwing this in, kind of like in case you had any doubts, you do this. The point of showing that demo, let's go through, if you remember, it's pretty memorable. I don't even have to re-show it because if you've seen the demo, you know the points in it. He sets it up in a way that's relevant to the audience, not relevant to the developers, but relevant to the audience. He doesn't attempt to go into vast detail about everything that's in the device. He doesn't explain why the demo's there or why he's giving a demo. He just jumps into, here's why you would want it. You only have to fire it once. A memorable way to characterize the product. He gives a dramatic product demo that has a tactile element to it, and then he moves and closes the deal. This is a classic demonstration with a demonstration playing a role in the sales process. Again, it's fictional, and so nothing can go wrong when you're doing fictional demonstrations. But at the same time, the mere fact that it's fiction allows you to see what the ideal would be, because no one sits down and does this sort of thing for actual products. But that is the perfect demonstration because it combines all those elements. It allows the customer to feel involved, emotionally involved with the product, and imagine what it would be like to use the product, imagine how things would be better, and then it moves on to the next stage in the sales cycle. So now, I'll go through the six rules again. Don't ever explain things. Always go for what the product, not even what the product does. It says, what does it mean to you? What are you trying to accomplish? If you're doing this, here's what you do to accomplish this thing. It's not all about why it does it or about the product itself. It's not about what it is or what it does. It's always about what the product means. That's what you're demonstrating. You're demonstrating not what it is or does, but what it would mean to the customer. You want to keep it so simple that it's memorable and that people can understand exactly what's going on throughout the demonstration. And then staying focused on one item, don't go into a bunch of lists of features and functions. Go directly into what someone would do, the most important thing that is of interest to them, and show how you're going to make life easier for them and make it as simple, straightforward as possible. If you can, make it vivid, get people involved in it. You can use that through different media techniques, or you can use it through handing people a piece of it, letting them demonstrate it themselves. Anything that gets the customer more involved or more emotionally interested in what you're doing is going to create a stronger demonstration, because again, the idea is to pull the customer into the environment, pull the customer into thinking about what it would be like to use the product. You want to rehearse enough times so that you feel completely confident about it. that way your confidence will communicate itself to other people, and also if you have any stage fright at all, which fortunately I no longer have, but I had at the time, if you have any stage fright at all, it'll keep you from having to cope with that. You can overcome it. If there's things weird happening during the demonstrations, distracting things, and I've certainly seen some pretty distracting things happen to demonstrations, the best defense against anything weird happening is to rehearse, so you know when you're there. And you want to prepare for technical questions. You want to make sure that you are able to know what they're going to do next, what they might say, get into the deeper level of information. And then you need to be able to close on the next step. And that's the key to it. You see, you look at where the demonstration, the role it's playing in your sales process. Sometimes demonstrations are at the beginning of the sales cycle. Sometimes they're at the close. Sometimes they're done it multiple times. But in every case, there's always going to be a next step. And so you want the demonstration to lead towards that next step and make sure that next step is included in the demonstration or concludes the demonstration. So I have been watching out of the corner of my eye. There are a lot of good questions. So I'm going to go directly to the questions at this point and go through them here. All right. What is suggested for demoing a service? I think if it's a service in terms of like a people-to-people service, then you would want to handle it like a video showing, you know, I would probably handle that kind of like I would use the style of reality television to show how the service worked. Like have, you know, the action happen and then have the different characters say, gee, when this happened, I thought it was blah, 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 you know, and just kind of have that angle, because that's the way that people are, that's probably the most easiest way to connect with people emotionally right now. Would it be beneficial to mention, another question, how similar companies and competitors use the product? If it's immediately relevant to the demonstration, yes, but I do not think that that would normally be part of the demonstration. It would be more part of the overall sales presentation. I'm not sure you want to get into what people's competitors are doing. You might use that to say, well, here's what they do at so-and-so, and then get into the simple demo that you planned. But you certainly don't want to get into a complicated discussion of how other companies use things. You kind of want to let them project themselves into it rather than see someone else into it. What if the product is B2B and very technical? Can you have explaining section about what the technical part is important? No. Do not do that in your demonstration. That is a bad idea. Demonstrations are for decision makers. They do not care about that technical detail. The reason why you want to do that is because you think it's interesting or your engineers think it's interesting. It's never interesting to anybody, the technical details. It can be you might have a technical presentation that discusses the technical features or a spec sheet that you give the engineers, but in the demonstration has to show usage. It's not an instruction on how the product was built or why it was built that way. Someone mentioned the rule of explain what you're going to show, show it, explain what you just showed. I think if something's simple enough, you don't need to do that. I've always seen that. I've heard that many times, and I've always said, well, that's what people do who are very boring. If you try to think about a conversation. If someone says, I'm now going to tell you how my day is, my day was great. I just told you my day is great. If you're having an actual conversation, if you're having an actual relationship or, you know, showing something that's sufficiently simple, it should be enough to say, here's what we're going to do, and we did it, and then move on to the next step. I think that that people encapsulate things to make them appear simpler when they're actually not simple. It's the same thing I always kind of get when I see someone run a line on like an acronym, like FACE, focus, action. To me, that just makes things, it adds a level of complexity. But if the ideas were simple enough to understand, you don't need to use little tricks, the presentation tricks. That's my personal opinion. Some people would probably feel more comfortable doing it like that. What if the product you're demonstrating addresses a long drive of problems, with many of which are important to the customer. There's a magic number of things to focus on and they've deemed relevant to their needs. Well, I could be flip and say, yeah, one is the magic number. But it's not so much whether it's the number of needs, it's how simple each one is described. If, for example, you have an RFP that has three specific functions that you need to do, yes, your demonstration needs to show all three of those functions. But what you don't want to do is show them in a big blotch. Oh, here are all the menus for all those threes, and now we're doing this, now we're doing, you want to say, okay, here's what you're doing first, and then you show the first thing. Now, suppose you're in this situation, and then you show the second thing. And then finally, in the end, here's what you do, and then you show the next function. So it's really a matter of keeping the narrative going through the multiple problems, rather than slamming everything into the, you know, a discussion of the problems as they are. How to pare down data to remove distractions and to use case scenarios, keep use case scenarios simple. Yeah, don't let your engineers build your case scenarios. Look at what your customers are doing. Or ask your customer, how would you use this, someone who you trust. It's very hard. I'm very sympathetic to people who work in marketing because it's really hard to get outside the internal view of how a product works and why it's there and what it's used for. Really the only solution to, the only way to get out of it is to hire someone from outside the company to do the writing and the building of the demo for you, or you need to ask a customer, get a customer or customers actively involved in how you're going to message and how you're going to describe it. A lot of consumer companies, by the way, have done that with consumer products. They've gotten people involved early on with using the product and talking about it, and that actually has resulted in some pretty impressive marketing campaigns. I think the most famous one is probably from Axe, AXE aftershave. That was all designed, that campaign was all designed by young men who were kind of fans of the product group and were cultivated by the company. How would the speaker handle a request for a client for a 3-hour presentation covering many different scenarios with a week's notice? You know, I would, if someone did that, I'd just assume that you were, that whenever a customer, this is a general rule about demonstrations or sales situations, whenever a customer or a potential customer demands something that is impossible or extremely difficult and requires a whole lot of effort, it's usually because they're trying to eliminate you out of the running and someone else already had the deal locked in. So if I saw someone said, we want you to give a 3-hour presentation in 1 week showing all this sort of stuff, I would probably say, what's in it for me? I would make them pay to do that demo because, like as not, they are just telling you to do something because they already have someone else in mind and they want to get you this involved. But, of course, then you've got to be in the politics of the situation to understand why that would work. But I'm always real suspicious when I hear unreasonable demands. Does the 20-minute rule apply to complicated software programs? Any tips to shorten the demo? Yeah, don't show everything. The demonstration isn't supposed to be exhaustive. The demonstration is just supposed to be the thing that's most important to that individual customer or that group of customers. So the tips to shorten the demo are to find out what's important to the customer and demonstrate that. Don't try to walk through everything that the product does. Don't try to shorten it by only talking about what's important. If there are technical questions, deviating from the demo script, how do you handle that best? Are you delaying to the end because you want to go through the demo and then you either be able to answer themselves or you have an engineer online and able to do that. Here's a good one. I'm an engineer and do demos. Do all these demos apply? My prospects generally want to see deeper explanation, but at the same time, I don't want to blast people with a fire hose. I think in that case, I'm assuming you're doing engineer to engineer at that point. If you're demoing engineer to engineer, you can do it a little bit differently because you can talk engineer talk. You can say, okay, here's what it does, here's what's working. And that's actually kind of a natural way to talk between engineers. But if you're demonstrating to decision makers who, you know, may have an engineering background or may have a background in sales or something like that, you pretty much have to do what I said here. You need to find out what's really important and only demonstrate that simple part. Do these rules get modified? Well, should you give a demo only if one partner is present? I think it depends on the product. I don't see why not. I mean, if you mean by one partner, meaning one customer, one individual, I don't see any reason why you wouldn't do that. I originally was thinking that there might be a difference, a reason to do two different, you know, that there's demos that are given in person, you know, to small groups, and demos given to people in large auditoriums. And the more I thought about it, the more I realized that those were really the same problem. There's really not that much difference between the two. I think, though, if you're demoing to a real small group or to one people, you just get much more relaxed about it, and you kind of sit on the same side of the table and say, oh, this is how it works. Yeah, I like this. And you make it more about the conversation, more of a conversation and less of a presentation. I think that would be true. If you ever know, think about it, when you're doing presentations, nothing's more corny than someone sitting down and with one-on-one and then flipping through their slides and giving their sales pitch. And that's so boring. You don't want to do that with a demo either. So if you're in a small group, you want to keep it a lot more casual. If it's a product that can evolve, can you use a demo to get customer feedback? That's not a good idea, no. No, that's not a demonstration. That's a research project. No, you don't want to say, well, this isn't finished. Do you have any ideas? That's not going to help you sell anything. I guarantee you that. That's another thing altogether. Okay, someone says, part of my challenge is sales reps using demonstrations as training sessions to build momentum for larger deals. What are your thoughts on applying the rules to existing customers on the solutions in that scenario? I get the customers to demo it. Show the customers what you want to demo to the other customers and get them to do it for you. That's the best way to do that. You might want to build a script and say, here's how to do it. But that's a whole other issue, which is how you get internal sales activity going. By the way, which is part of building a following amongst your customers, is getting it to spread. Can you comment on using external audio, music sound effects within a demo? You can do it minimally. If you run the music heavy under the background so that it starts sounding like an industrial video, I think it detracts. It doesn't really add anything. It's almost like people stick the music in because they know they're being boring, so they try to put an exciting soundtrack in the background. Or they got a guy who has an announcer voice to do the line. This product does that or that, you know, like a guy on the radio. If you've done your homework and turned this into something that's interesting and relevant to the customer, you don't need to pump up the music or pump up the voice in order to make it seem interesting. Someone says, do you say we tailor each on-site demo to be specific to the end user requirements? That's an easy one. Yes. Is there a place for an even-keel demonstration versus a high demonstration of the product? I think that high energy is appropriate if it's something that's really exciting, but so it depends on your style. If you're naturally sort of introverted and thoughtful, I think trying to come off like, you know, really outgoing is just going to sound false. You want to be excited about something, excited about the product, but excited in the way that you're excited about it, like because you love what you're doing, not necessarily because you feel compelled to talk loudly about it. Question, all products are not perfect, but some weak areas. Would you mention that? No, I would not mention that. Honesty increases credibility. Just show perfect world. This is not the time to be talking about the weaknesses of the product. You can bring that out when it comes up as farther along in the sales cycle, or when, if you see that they really need something that isn't there later. It's not so much a perfect world, you just want to show what's relevant. So you kind of don't want to get into that discussion at this point. If doing a GoToMeeting demo, GoToMeeting is a product that people use for teleconferencing. Can I start with a 5-page slide about my company? No. I would not do that. I'll tell you why. And this is a general thing with sales presentation. No one cares about your company very much. You've got something short. One slide, like in this one, explaining what it is. Yes, definitely do that. but don't go into your corporate history in detail or all this sort of stuff, because frankly, that's all not really that important to customers. What customers want to know is what's in it for me. So this is true, and this is one of the things that I teach, by the way, in my master's program, is the art of getting yourself out of the picture. The biggest mistake and most common mistake that people make in sales and marketing is thinking that selling and marketing has something to do with me, not with the customer. It has to do with me. And so people talk about, I feel this way, or our company, and really customers don't care about that. They just don't. They don't care about how you feel. They don't care about what your design process is or anything like that. All they care about is what does it mean to me and what can I do with it. People are selfish, customers included. So at the bottom line, you're saying a demo should have an underlying story that you're telling, one that emotionally resonates with the audience. Am I right? Yes. Tony Stark is overly amusing and cocky confident. Okay, well, yeah, I'll give you that, but I don't think anyone's really going to be imitating him to that degree. So when you need to show many functions that address client problems, you recommend space demos with activities, breaks, live discussions, or PowerPoints. I think what you're saying there, if you're doing multiple demos, you would demo each section separately with its own narrative. And yeah, if it's going to be longer than 20 minutes, I'd break it up. But try to only do that if that's what the customer's actually requested. The mistake is that people make is they make, one of the mistakes that people make is they tend to make their demonstrations more complicated than they need to be. So you want to kind of limit it down to what's actually relevant to the customer. How many attempts should be made if something you were demonstrating error failed? I'd go with 2, and then I'd cut to the video. And if it's something that you're sure is fatal, like the minute the guy presenting the Surface, who, again, that's actually a pretty good product. It just demonstrated poorly coming out the gate. But the guy was demonstrating that when he should have gotten a clue when the first time he hit it, he didn't get what he wanted. He should have known that he had a problem right then. He should have had something back up right there. Right there, he should have something, like, even if he had just another one lying there that was already had games on it, he usually picked it up and start showing them the games, because the system was hung, probably trying to access the internet, which is a very common problem in live demos. So, we've got 3 minutes left. I wanted to mention that if you're interested in getting followers and customers, that's kind of like my superpower, and I'm going to be giving a mastery workshop on that the week of September 7th. It's four hours a day, and it's how to use websites, emails, all this stuff to create a following of customers based upon my experience of doing that 3 times. The corporate weight's 25. I usually charge an individual weight of 2,500, but today, to anyone who's attended this, it's only going to be 2,000. And you can email me if you're interested in that. I'm not going to go on and on about it, because those of you who know you need it, and those who don't know you don't. So with that, I'll hand it over to Rebecca.
All right. Thank you, Geoffrey, for a great presentation. Remember, our webinars tie directly to our Box of the Month initiative, where we highlight a different topic from the framework each month and provide extra information, insights, and implementation guidance in that area. Our webinar program will be on summer vacation next month, but we will be back strong in September with a webinar on user scenarios, so be sure to join us then. We will be sending out an email tomorrow with a link to this presentation. That does it for this edition of Pragmatic Live. Thank you for joining us, and have a great rest of the week.
Bye-bye, everyone.